Very much. So I would like to start by thanking the organizers for inviting me to this wonderful place. So it's a real pleasure. I have been having a lot of fun, both scientifically and non-scientifically. So I have been asked to give a super pedagogical talk, and I will try to do my best at the expense of half of you maybe getting bored with what I am going to say. But my aim is that most of you understands most of what I am going to say. So if you feel the need to stop me at any time, please, I encourage you to ask as many questions as you want. I will use the blackboard. And basically what I will be talking about is called the analytic bootstrap or the analytic conformal bootstrap. And it's a technique to study conformal field theories in general dimensions, and especially in dimensions higher than 2, which is when they are harder. And the idea is that in lectures 1 and 2, I will describe the general method, and I will keep things very general. And in the third lecture, I will describe a specific application. And I will start, so although most of you may have heard about conformal field theories, and we have heard about it in some of the previous talks, let me start just by setting the notation, etc. So we have seen that all conformal field theories share in common what we call the conformal algebra. The conformal algebra is spanned by the Poincaré algebra, so we have Poincaré, which is generated by translations P mu and Lorentz rotations, and mu nu. Here, mu runs from 1 to the number of dimensions d. In addition, if the theory is conformal, we have also scale transformations, and scale transformations are generated by the dilatation operator D. So this is the dilatation operator. And then, in addition, there is this very weird set of transformations, which is called special conformal transformations, given by K mu. And all these generators generate what we call the conformal algebra. Now, in addition, of course, whenever you consider a specific theory may have additional global symmetries. However, I want to keep the discussion general, and I want to use only this structure. So what I am going to say for the next two lectures will be true, valid, for any conformal field theory in dimensions higher than 2. Is that okay? And so, this is part of the hype about this conformal bootstrap, and is that it's quite general, provided the theory is conformal. Is that okay? Is this clear? Good. So the main ingredient that we have, so the ingredients of a conformal field theory is a set of conformal primary operators. Can you see that if I write here? Yeah. Conformal primary operator. O delta Lx. So as you see, I usually abbreviate the words a lot. This is actually due to 2 things. First, I write very slowly. And second, I usually don't know very well the spelling in English. But if some word is not very clear for you, ask me. So this means conformal primary operator. And so the conformal primary operator is a set of operators, O delta Lx, and they are eigenfunctions of the Hamiltonian, of the dilatation operator, sorry. So they are eigenfunctions of the dilatation operator D with eigenvalue delta. And this delta is called the dimension, or sometimes the scaling dimension, of the operator. In addition, the operators are also labeled by their Lorentz spin. So this L is the Lorentz spin. And they are local operators, so they depend on a point x. So there are some O delta L x. Is that okay? And the fact that they are primaries, if you want to be very fancy, means that they are annihilated by, when they are at the origin, they are annihilated by these special conformal transformations. You should think of them very much as the ground state of the harmonic oscillator, which is annihilated by annihilation operators. But the fact is that in a conformal field theory, there are many ground states. So there are many such primary operators. In addition, for a given primary operator, you have a tower, so an infinite tower of descendants. And these descendants are given by P acting on the primary operators. And it turns out that on operators, this P basically acts as derivatives, so these are just derivatives of primary operators. So you have primary operators, which you can think of them as not being derivatives of anyone, and then you have all the derivatives of these primary operators, and these are the descendants, yes?
And when you say Lorentz spin, are you in Lorentzian signature, or?
I will be very precise about that later. So I will be in Minkowskian signature. And for me, it will be important to be in Minkowskian signature. I will tell you precisely when I will use that fact.
But still, you did not knew you have one to D, from one to D.
Yes, okay. But yeah, that's right. Okay. But I can use 0 D minus 1, if you wish. But you know, time could be any, so it is.
Okay.
But it's actually a very important question. And later, I will go back to that. Is that okay? Then we have a beautiful property in conformal field theories, and it's the fact that these local operators form an algebra. And this algebra, so let me, if I write it here, can people in the back see? Yeah? Yeah, very good. So because this is the most important result of CFT, so I don't want you to miss that. But basically, the name of that is the operator product expansion. And what the operator product expansion says is that if I take two local operators and put them together, two local primary operators, let's say OI X OJ at zero, here with I denote delta I LI, so it's some generic primary operator and another generic primary operator, you can write this down as an infinite sum of local operators on the right. This is actually pretty cool as a statement. We will see why. And this here, you can furthermore write down as a sum over primaries of some coefficient C, I, J, K, some powers of X, delta K minus delta I minus delta J. And here, you got the following tower. So you got OK itself, evaluated at zero. But then you also get descendants of this OK. For instance, X mu d mu OK at zero plus dot, dot, dot. Now, this is true also in quantum field theory, in general quantum field theory. But the important point about a conformal field theory is that in a conformal field theory, this coefficient, so the coefficient in front of the descendants, is fixed by conformal symmetry. Is that okay? So, yes?
What is the space in XK?
Sorry.
On
so,
the O0?
K.
On the O0, the first one?
K.
Yeah, that K.
Sorry about it. Yeah, my K sucks, but. Sorry about that.
Is it always one for the first one?
Sorry?
Is it Is that one always one, or is there a coefficient there that you?
It's always one, because basically, whatever the coefficient here is, you absorb it into Cijk.
No, for the second one, for x mu d mu.
I don't remember if it is one.
No, I'm just wondering.
It's fixed.
It's fixed.
I think if you want to be precise, I think it's. It depends on delta somehow. We can work it out. It may be this combination over two or something like that. But it's fixed. That's the important point. Is that okay? So, summarizing, on the right hand side, you have primaries and descendants. But the important point is that the coefficient of all the descendants is fixed by conformal invariance. Is that okay? Now, you should be very happy about that, but in a minute, we will see how cool that is. Yeah.
Sorry,
curious,
if that's all fixed by conformal, has anyone work out a closed form?
Yes, I will tell you. I will tell you a lot about that. I can tell you as much as you want, and I will tell you as much as I am able to with the time constraints I have. Now, so these Cijk coefficients are quite important. And sometimes we will denote these coefficients by OP coefficients. So if you are at a party and someone talks about OP coefficients, that's what they mean. OP coefficients. And you see that as we will see in a second, the set of all the delta i's for all your theory, for all the operators in your theory, this is called the spectrum of the theory, plus the set of all Cijk for any triplets of primaries is what characterizes the conformal field theory, and this is what we call the CFT data. So the aim of people in this business is to determine the CFT data for conformal field theories. It's not easy. It's a pain in the neck. Usually, it's very complicated. It depends on coupling constants, number of colors, the theory may not be perturbative, but in principle, this is what you want to compute. Is that okay? Good. Any questions? Very nice. So this is the main ingredient. So we have these conformal primary operators, O, delta L, X. And then the main observable are correlators of these operators. So you take some of these operators, O1 at x1, dot dot dot, On at xn, and these are the observables of your theory. These are the kind of things. This is one of the most natural things that you can study in a conformal field theory. Is that okay? Now, it turns out that conformal field theory, conformal symmetry, is very powerful, and the space-time dependence of this is constrained by conformal invariance. And it is so much that, for instance, you can show, and we were shown already the formula yesterday, that 2 and 3 point functions are completely fixed by conformal invariance. So for instance, the two point functions of scalar operators, if you are curious, so I x1, OJ x2, conformal invariance implies that this is 0 if delta I is different from delta J, and otherwise, you can always normalize it in such a way that this delta ij divided x12 to 2 delta I. For delta I equals to delta j, where I have introduced this notation x12 to denote x1 minus x2. Is that okay? And in addition, the same is true for the three-point function of operators. So for instance, the three-point function of scalar operators has a slightly more complicated form, but this OI x1, OJ x2, OK x3, and this has a numerator, which happens to be CIJK, and then here is something like x12, well, to the delta I plus delta J minus delta K. This is a bit long, but x13 to a similar combination, and x23 to a similar combination too. Is that okay? So you see that in particular, this numerator is exactly the CIJK that appears, that is the OP coefficients that appear in the OP algebra, so that if I give you all the delta i's and all the CIJK, you can immediately write down all the two-point functions and the three-point functions of the conformal field theory. Is that okay? Questions?
So here's the measure that we are using to define the correlators. You have in mind some action principle or
not? You don't need to.
No.
So if the theory, of course, if the theory is a Lagrangian theory and you can go to some weakly coupled regime, then you would be able to compute this CIJK and this delta I's as a perturbation in this small coupling constant. So you, there is a way with finite diagrams to compute them. However, in none of what I will say, I will use or assume that there is a Lagrangian for the CFT. So that's also part of the power of all this. I'm going to use only symmetries because I'm lazy. So we are not going to use any Lagrangian or Feynman diagrams. And that's, yeah, that's what we will do. Is that okay? Now, we can, by now we are getting really excited. And we say, two-point functions are kind of trivial. Three-point functions are trivial too. What about four-point functions? And luckily, because otherwise I wouldn't be giving this talk here, and I would be in Oxford. So the four-point function is non-trivial. And the simplest quantity, the simplest non-trivial quantity, is the four-point function. And for the four-point function, conformal symmetry still helps a lot. And says, imagine, so I will consider the simplest one, which is the four-point function of four identical operators. So we have phi, so here phi is any scalar operator, x1, phi x2, phi x3, phi x4, and what conformal invariants tell us is that this is an arbitrary function of two cross ratios, u and v, which I will define in a second, up to a prefactor that has to be there by dilatation invariants. And the expression for these two cross ratios is the following. So u is x12 square, x34 square, over x13 square, x24 square, and v is equal to x14 square x2 for the square divided by x13 squared, x2 for the square. And these two quantities, u and v, are denoted as conformal invariant cross ratios, or simply cross ratios. Their expression is very important. It will play a very important role in these two talks, and the three actually, so.
Yeah, we're mistaken.
Sorry?
It's x14, x23, sorry.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you. Yeah, so, and one can check, actually, that, sorry, would you, I can borrow your watch? So I can keep track of how bad I am doing with time. Sorry about that. So thank you so much. I will give it back. Thank you. Yes, so the important thing about these conformal cross ratios is that if you do any conformal transformation, P, M, K, and D, on these quantities, they are invariant under conformal transformations. And what happens is that you need at least 4 points to make them. If I give you only 3 points, you cannot make them. And that's the reason why 2 and 3 point functions couldn't depend on anything non-trivial. Because you cannot build with only 3 locations a conformal invariant quantity. Other way of putting it is that if you have 4 points, you can choose conformal invariants to fix 3 of them whenever you like, but the 4th gives you an extra freedom, and this extra freedom is encoded in these 2 combinations, U and V. Is that okay? Wonderful. So now there may seem that this function is a completely arbitrary function, but it turns out that we can do the following. So we can consider now, imagine that you have these two, these 4, and then you would consider the OPE of phi x1, phi x2. So you write these 2 operators as an infinite sum, as we have seen in the OPE, and you also consider the OPE of phi x3 with phi x4. So basically, what we are doing, if we do this, then it means that we can decompose the 4-point function into conformal partial waves. We have a very nice pictorial representation for that. And the representation is the following. So if we have the 4-point function, phi x1, phi x4, we can write this as a sum over intermediate operators labeled by delta and L. And here we have phi x1, phi x2. This goes to some intermediate operator O delta L, and then this intermediate operator becomes phi x4, phi x3. Is that okay? So when you do the OPE, you can show that phi x1 and phi x2 is an infinite sum over primary operators, and phi x3, phi x4 is also an infinite sum over local operators. But you may recall that the 2-point function of primary operators have this delta ij, so that makes that actually this operator and this operator have to be the same. And you can show that. Is that okay? So, if we do that at the level of formulas, we can write down the fact that this GUV here, and this is a very nice formula, GUV, is a sum over conformal primary operators. And then notice that when you do an OPE, you will here, you will acquire an OPE coefficient. So this is proportional to some C. Let's denote this OPE coefficient by C delta L. So this is the OPE coefficient of phi with O. And we pick another OPE coefficient from here. So we get a sum over primary operators. So these are conformal primaries. In the phi with phi of E, each conformal primary is weighted by the square of the OPE coefficients, one arising from here and another arising from here. Is that okay? And then each one has this function here, G delta L UV. And this function is a very important function, and this is the function which is called conformal block. And basically, you would remember that when I told you in the OPE decomposition, the coefficient of all the descendant operators were fixed in terms of all primary operators, in terms of this Cijk, the relative coefficient was always fixed. And because of that, this whole function, once you have said what C is also completely fixed. So this function is completely fixed by conformal symmetry. And what it does is, for a given primary, it takes into account the contribution of all the descendants of that primary. Is that okay? Yeah, is it clear? Yeah, so basically its purpose is, so this is a sum only over primaries, and you have this OP coefficients squared, and then these functions, they are quite terrible. I will tell you a few things about these conformal blocks. But basically, they give, so they encode the contribution from all the descendants of a given primary. Now, someone asked me whether the expansion of the OPE was known in a closed form. So the more interesting question is whether these conformal blocks, is an equivalent question, whether these conformal blocks are known in a closed form. Now, for external scalar operators, as I am doing now, they are known in even number of dimensions. In odd dimensions, they are extremely complicated, and we don't know a closed form expression for them. We know only a series expansions. But in general, they depend on U, V, they depend on delta and L of the intermediate operator, and they also depend on the number of dimensions. Is that okay? So let me write a few things about them. I think this is a good time. So is there any questions before I get really technical for like 5 minutes? No? Okay. So let me tell you about these conformal blocks. So the first thing is that they are fixed. They are in principle fixed by conformal invariants. So let's use blue for conformal blocks. And they have very nice properties. So in four dimensions, let me give you the following, for instance. So in the small u behavior, something that you can show is that g delta l uv, sometimes people introduce the following notation. They say that this is u to the tau over 2 f of tau l uv. And here is just a change of notation. This tau is delta minus l, and it's called the twist of the primary operator. So the twist is nothing too fancy. By definition, it's the dimension minus the spin. And that's it. Now, in terms of this, you can show that when u is small, these conformal blocks go like u to the twist over 2 times a function which depends on tau on L, v, plus higher powers of u, which we don't care. And this sometimes is called a collinear conformal block. So I'm just saying, I give you these horrible expressions in Mathematica. You do CES around v equals 0. The first order, around u equals 0, sorry. The first order is this u to the tau over 2, where tau is the twist of the conformal operator, and of the conformal primary. And if you are, if you want to know, if you are really curious about this, I can give you the expression for this. So how many of you would like the expression for this? Good. So this, thank you. I will pay your coffee. So the expression for this tau L, collinear, sorry about that, it's a bit nasty, is 1 minus V to the spin, and then this lovely 2F1 hypergeometric functions, tau over 2 plus L, tau over 2 plus L, tau plus 2L, 1 minus V. So they are given by a hypergeometric function. How many here have met hypergeometric functions before? Okay, so I can tell you as much as you wish. So these are solutions of a second order differential equation. They are given by some infinite sum of this V, and they are a little nasty, but you get used to it after a while. But they are very explicit. And something that you can show, for instance, you can take, again, this in Mathematica, and you can see what happens when V is small.
Fernando?
Yes?
So since the dimension is arbitrary, L is not really one number. In general, it's a set of numbers linking.
Say that again?
Since the dimension...
Yes, that's a very good point. So you, as you will see, if you have the... yeah, that's absolutely a good point. Now, if you have two identical operators, the only operators that will appear in the OPE can be labeled by a single number L.
The first linking
level
or what?
It's like the diagonal. But I will be super precise.
Okay.
And
so the twist in general will always be defined by this L that you made?
Yeah, well, yes, absolutely. So there will be a single L. Indeed, I mean, in general, the spin has to be labeled by some Cartan subalgebra of SOD, of course. But in the kind of operators we will consider, you can think of these operators as d mu 1, d mu L O, and L is exactly that. So it's in the symmetric traceless representation of the Lorentz group. And this is the kind of things that you have to think about when I say L. Yeah, good. Yes, and something that you can see, for instance, is that these conformal blocks, for a small b, they don't have a very nice behavior, and they actually diverge. You can check from here, or you can check for the full conformal block. They go like logarithm log of b. Is that okay? And while around v equals 1, the expression is nice. So I am not being very precise what I mean by nice, but anyway, but it's nice. Is that okay? So you have these expressions in Mathematica. They are very complicated expressions, but they are very fully fixed by conformal symmetry. In the small u limit, they go like u to the twist divided by 2, where the twist is delta minus L. And this coefficient, this function, is fully known for all functions of V and all dimensions. So this one is independent of the number of dimensions. The next depends on the number of dimensions, but this one does not. And for a small v, it diverges, but only logarithmically. Is that okay? Very good. So we will come back to that in a second. But before that, are there any questions you would like to ask? Yeah? Good. So notice the first surprise, the first thing that should come as a surprise, is that in a way, maybe in a hard way, but once you know the spectrum of your theory and the spectrum of OPE coefficients, you can also write down the four-point function. And actually, if you have a 20-point function, you could do the OPE of the first two, of these two, these two, these two, and start reducing. And at the end of the day, you end up with an expression really complicated, extremely complicated. But any correlator, you can write down in terms of the CFT data, which are these OPE coefficients and the spectrum of your theory. Is that okay? Of course, this is a little bit abstract, because I am telling you, you can do this, but this is a double infinite sum over a spectrum you don't know, with OPE coefficients you don't know, with really complicated functions of U and V and the number of dimensions. But in principle, that's what, that's it. So if you compute deltas and Cs, you become very happy, you hang it on your wall, and that's it. And you will get probably a few prizes. Is that okay? Now, the idea of the bootstrap, so, we have this expression here. We have this. So let me do the following. So the question the bootstrap answers is the following. It's like not every conformal CFT data will produce a consistent conformal field theory. So the question we ask now, we would like to have a consistent conformal field theory. Is that okay? Can you see in the back? Yeah. And in particular, if the conformal field theory is consistent, the four-point function of identical operators should be crossing symmetric. So if I am taking the correlator of the four tips of my fingers and they are identical, if I exchange two of them, the correlator should still be the same. In particular, I should be able to exchange x1 with x3, so this is the interesting one. And if you see the expressions for the conformal cross ratios that I just erased, these exchanges u with v. And if you go to the four-point correlator and require that the four-point correlator are equal, this tells you that this correlator, 2 delta phi, should be equal to the correlator where you have exchanged x1 and x3. So this is GVU divided by x23 to the 2 delta phi, x14 to the 2 delta phi. And if you remember, you can write this purely in terms of the cross ratios. And what this implies is that V to the delta phi GUV is equal to U to the delta phi GVU. And this is the crossing condition that we have for a correlator. So the four-point correlator is not quite an arbitrary function of U and V. It's a function which has to satisfy this crossing condition, simply because it's the four-point function of four identical operators. Is that okay? But then we see that actually we have this expression here, and we have this decomposition here as well, right? So now, people soon realize that actually this, together with this, is quite a non-trivial equation. It's quite a non-trivial condition. And in order to see how much non-trivial that is, we do the following. So, sorry, allow me to erase, and then I will rewrite, but I want the final equation to be written in a nice way. So I do this. So the first thing you do is you combine this crossing equation with the usual decomposition that I just wrote, that I just erased. But now we are going to do the following. So this is just a matter of taste, but it makes things more drastic. So here, what I am doing, I am singling out the identity operator. So the identity operator is an operator which is always present in the OPE of phi with itself, and it doesn't have any descendants, because if you take the derivative of 1, you get 0, you can check with Mathematica. And so the conformal block for the identity is 1, the OPE coefficient is just 1. So this is the decomposition where I have singled out the identity operator. But then you see that what this is telling me, together with crossing symmetry, is that the decomposition in this channel should be equal to the decomposition on a different channel. Or in formulas, V to the delta phi 1 plus sum over delta L G of. Delta L squared G delta L UV has to be equal to U to the delta phi 1 plus sum over delta L C delta L squared G delta L V U. And sometimes people denote this as the direct channel, and this as the dual channel, or crossed. Now, stare at this equation. This is a remarkable equation. What we are saying is that no matter what the spectrum of your theory is, the spectrum of your theory, as we have said, can be extremely complicated function of the coupling constants of your theory, the number of colors if you are considering a gauge theory, etc. this is extremely complicated. The OP coefficients are extremely complicated, and the conformal blocks are extremely complicated too. What we are saying is that this homologous sum on the left-hand side, for all values of U and V, has to be identical to the horrible sum on the right-hand side. And this is highly, highly, highly non-trivial. And what it makes this very hard to use, what makes it very hard to use, and actually people wrote this, and for 20 years they were staring at it, and they didn't know what to do with it. And what makes this very hard is that the direct channel, because of the properties of the conformal blocks, it has a nice expansion, converges nicely around U equals 0 and V equals 1, while the right-hand side converges nicely V equals 0 and U equals 1. And the interplay between the left and the right is incredibly complicated. If you take one operator here, you take just one conformal block, this one conformal block will map to an infinite double sum of messy conformal blocks on the right. So this is the bootstrap equation. It's what is the equation that we will try to study the most. And basically, I will show you in the next lecture how to retrieve analytic information about the spectrum of conformal field theories just by analyzing this equation. But I just want to give you a feeling that this equation is beautiful and extremely complicated at the same time. Is that okay? Any questions? I think now is a good time if you have a couple of questions. Yes?
You said that what you want is that the safety must be consistent to have bootstrap, but I don't understand what you mean by consistency.
Right. So by consistent, so here, so let's try to understand which kind of things I have used. I haven't used much. I have said that just by using conformal symmetry, if you use conformal symmetry, then the conformal block decomposition, the decomposition in conformal block, follows from conformal symmetry. But in addition, if the conformal field theory is nice, then it turns out that it should also be crossing symmetric. So by consistent, I am only using, in order to arrive to this equation, I have only used the fact that the four-point function of identical operators is crossing symmetric. That I mean by a consistent CFT. And also the fact that it's conformal, so we have also used conformal invariance. But notice that nowhere we have used that the CFT is weakly coupled, we haven't used that the fact that it has a Lagrangian description. There is another thing that you may want to use, and it's important in the numerical bootstrap, and it's the fact that the theory is unitary. And if the theory is unitary, I have an interval. We have seen glimpses of that in the previous talks. But basically what happens is that delta cannot be too low, so there is a limit on what delta can be. I will tell that later. And also, the OP coefficients have to be real numbers, so that the square of the OP coefficients have to be non-negative. They have to be positive numbers. And it turns out that this is very important for the numerical bootstrap, to achieve this equality with positive coefficients, C delta L square. So, but I don't want to enter, but if you put a random spectrum and you try to solve for the coefficient C, most of the time you will get negative coefficient C square. And that's not consistent with unitarity. So by a consistent CFT, I mean, it has conformal symmetry, so that we can show that we have a conformal block decomposition. The four-point function is fully symmetric, so it's crossing symmetric, and sometimes we will use unitarity as well. Is that okay? Any other question? Yes.
So this OBE equation will only allow you to fix the OBE coefficients that correspond to...
No, I mean, if you know, so this equation has to be true, and actually we will see that it will also give us information on what the spectrum is.
Also what the spectrum, yeah, but the OBE coefficients that appear in this particular block, they only correspond to...
Absolutely, fully agree, absolutely, yes. So that's a very important observation. Notice that this sum runs only over the intermediate operators that appear in the OP phi with phi. The theory may have other operators, and these other operators appear on other four-point functions. So in principle, if you want to say, oh, this CFT is fully consistent, you need to study all four-point functions so as you cover all the intermediate operators. That's a very important. But I am not good, so I consider one and the simplest one.
Is there a value of U equals V where the expansion is good?
Yes, actually. So, and I will tell that a bit better in the last talk. Okay. But basically, indeed, so the basic idea is that you can explore this in different regions. And the numerical bootstrap, they studied this at a symmetric point that happens to be U equals V equals 1/4. And at that symmetric point, you can expand both sides. And you can basically, the thing is that you can truncate both sums, and convergence is more or less OK. So you can study numerical. But in what I will do something completely crazy. And I will go to the end of the radius of convergence of this sum. And we will study this sum at that point. You will see. But it's an important question. Yes?
So we started with something quite general, but
yes.
We have in regular quantum field theory, we have an issue where it's possible to produce non-physical states. Here we've done something very general. How could we find whether states or operator product expansions correspond to physical, non-physical states?
Yeah, so here it's important to have conformal symmetry. So here you are not in a usual quantum field theory, you will not have any of this. So it will be much less powerful. So this is true only for conformal field theories. Now, it is true that conformal, sometimes you can write down conformal field theories, and they look consistent. For instance, one particular case, and people doesn't understand very well, is the ON model. The ON model, in principle, you could write it down for all n, but you know that if n is not integer, the theory shouldn't be physical somehow. So sometimes what happens is that some of these, you see problems in some of these intermediate operators. It's not easy at this level. So we will see necessary conditions for consistency of CFT, but in principle you need to study all four-point correlators, and it could be that some catches this intermediate operator which is not physical. And there are theories that in principle you could do this for ON models even when n is not integer, but you know that shouldn't be right. Or you can also do for the Wilson-Fisher model in 4 minus epsilon, but that should be a unitary only when epsilon is equal to 1. And so these are interesting questions. Good. So let me, because I am, can I take like 10 more minutes? Is that okay? So is this okay? Any other questions? Beautiful. So let me tell you a solution of this equation, because it's nice to be able to play with these things. All looks nice, so I don't want to erase anything. But let me erase this this nice equation. And let me give you the simplest solution of crossing. That will be also important in the last talk. So the simplest solution is called generalized free fields. So generalized free fields, they correspond basically to a Gaussian theory. So it means, but as you will see, the Gaussian theory is already highly non-trivial, but we will analyze all what I have said for this very nice Gaussian theory. And so you have four scalar fields, x1, x2, x3, x4. And the answer is the sum of three terms that are all the possible ways in which you can do weak contractions between these fields. So for instance, you can do weak contraction like this and like this, or you could do weak contraction between the last and the first and the last, and these two, and you will have the other term, which is these two and these two. And then you just, the theory is just Gaussian, so this is very simple. So this is 1 over x1, 2 to the 2 delta phi, x3, 4 to the 2 delta phi. So basically, what generalized free fields means is not exactly a free theory. If you have a scalar field, a fundamental scalar field, in a free theory, the dimension of the field should be fixed to something like d minus 2 over 2 or whatever. But here, you are doing weak contractions, but still you assume that this is 1 over x2 to the 2 delta phi, where delta phi is generic. Is that okay? So we are studying this model for generic delta phi. From this diagram, we get 1 over x14 to the 2 delta phi, x13 to the 2 delta phi, plus 1 over x13 to delta phi, x24 to delta phi. So this comes from here, this comes from this one, and this comes from this one. And if you remember how we wrote our two-point function like this, our four-point function like this, this, you can write it down as the prefactor and what is left, you can write it fully in terms of the cross ratios. So here you have 1 plus u to the delta phi plus u over v to the delta phi. And this is the GUV of generalized free fields. Is that okay? And indeed, something that you can check, so this is a very neat, nice model. You can play a lot with it. And something that you can see is that indeed, V to the delta phi GUV is equal to U to the delta phi GVU. Is that okay? Excellent. We can learn much more from this model, and we can take this, and we can also do the conformal block decomposition of that. I will not work the details, but I will give you the results. And the results are quite interesting. So basically what you need to do, you need to ask me for the expressions of the conformal blocks. You can take, let's say, four dimensions. And once you have the conformal blocks, you can say, okay, I want to write the correlator, 1 plus u to the phi plus u over v to the delta phi. And I want to express this as 1 plus, nice, the 1 takes care of, a sum over some intermediate operators, tau and L, of some OP coefficients, u to the tau over 2, f tau l uv. And here I am using this notation. So for instance, question to you. Look at tau here, and look at the power of u on both sides. Can you tell me what is the twist of the intermediate operators? It's kind of easy. You need to solve delta phi equals to tau over 2. So what you can see from here is that the intermediate operators are the following. So let me erase this now, so to make some space. And you see that we have the identity operator. Just the one here. But in addition, we have an infinite tower of double trace operators. And these double trace operators are operators whose twist is 2 delta phi. But then what you see is that if you use only 2 delta phi, you will get an extra power of u on the right-hand side that you need to cancel somehow. So you need also to add 2 delta phi plus 2. And you also need to add 2 delta phi plus 4. And what you can see is that the intermediate operators, there is a tower of intermediate operators with this twist. But remember that the twist was delta minus L. So delta is L plus, so it's 2 delta phi plus 2n plus L. And these are the double trace operators. And the existence of these double trace operators, you can actually understand if you think a second about this. Because they are of the form, or they are labeled by this n and the spin L. And they are basically given by phi with a change of derivatives. You can have, for instance, box n times d mu 1, d mu l, and acting on phi. So in the free theory, or in the Gaussian model, the intermediate operators are operators of this kind. And for instance, something that is really cool is that if you take this, and you can compute these OP coefficients. But these OP coefficients are exactly the three-point function between O and these operators here, which, you know, is a bit difficult to compute. So it's not that easy to compute. And from this, you can easily compute it. Is that okay? So this is the simplest model, but actually it would be really cool. So what is cool, you know, about generalized free fields is that when we will study holographic conformal field theories, the leading term, the zero order term, will be generalized free fields. So this will be the basis to study holographic theories. We will do that in the third talk. But for now, we have a very simple model, a very cute GUV, which satisfies crossing symmetry, and also you can decompose into conformal blocks, and you can see that these are the intermediate operators. Is that okay? Any questions? Yes?
Could you repeat the argument for the 2n?
Absolutely. So the argument from the 2n, basically, you can see it as follows. So here, by matching the powers of u on the left and on the right, you see that you need tau to be equal to 2 delta phi. Very happy. However, this one, this function, has also higher powers of u. So you will get u to the 0, but you will also get u to the 1, right? And in order to cancel that, so this is u to the 0, u squared, u cubed. And in order to cancel the u, you need to add another tower of operators with twist exactly 2 delta phi plus 2. But then you would have to cancel the u to the tau over 2 times u squared.
It's because you know those functions.
Absolutely. You know these functions. I can give them to you. They are some hypergeometric functions. let's say I can give them in two dimensions, in four dimensions, and you can play, you can do this decomposition very explicitly, and you find, and what you find, which is quite cool and surprising from this point of view, is that, yes, so I forgot something, which is will be quite interesting, that the C and L square are exactly positive. So this is not guaranteed, right? When you match these two things, you start solving equations and you have to cancel things. The fact that this will be positive is quite cool. And it tells you that this kind of generalized free fields is a nice theory consistent with unitarity. And we will denote this by GFF. I can give you the expression for this if you want to. It's on ratios of gamma functions. It's not so easy. But the important point is that they are positive, and you can find these coefficients just by playing around. It took my student 4 days, but it should be nice. If you have everything, you compute things, and you have to guess, and it's a nice exercise. Is that okay? I think, yes, that's all for today. So I want you to sleep tonight, so I won't tell you, but let me tell you. So it's a tease for the next lecture. And the following tease for the next lecture, so tomorrow, we will start by a puzzle, by solving a puzzle. And the puzzle is the following question. How does every conformal block on the right-hand side diverge as you take V to zero? I didn't erase the important information here. For V goes to zero, every conformal block diverges logarithmically. But the left-hand side diverges as a power law in 1 over V. So the first thing we will do, we will try to understand that puzzle, how that is possible, and then we will see that is actually the basis of the analytic bootstrap. Trying to understand this very simple fact, and and basically that's what we will do tomorrow. Thank you very much.
So, any more questions for Fernando?
Yes.
So, basically, what information can So I'm talking about the operator product coefficient. So yes. What information can you derive from that? Or what can you relate to maybe parameter?
Yeah, so in a way, it's like a transition. It's like a transition amplitude. So what is the probability, if you have two states, what is the probability that produces a third state? So in the kind of, for instance, in holographic theories, there is a question if each this operator will be like a single particle state, and double trace operators will be two particle states, and you can think also about multi-trace states that are multi-particle states, and this OP coefficient is basically the ratio with which you can produce that. So there is a lot of theorems, and people would like to know, for instance, how this behaves with n, etc. So, so all these kind of questions is quite important. Also, for instance, if you consider so here I am considering only the four-point function of scalar operators, you could consider a stress tensor. And it turns out that the OP coefficients of three stress tensors is a very important quantity. And there is a lot of theorems in gravity that tells you that this has to be positive, or this has to go like that, or like this. So, but this roughly information about production. So because you are going from two states to one state, and sometimes you want to know. But also, it can tell you whether the theory is unitary or not. So because you want this C squared to be positive. So, yeah. But more mathematically, you can say that the OP coefficients, so if you what is exactly the opposite of what you asked me, since you said physically. But let me tell you mathematically. So the OP coefficient is like an algebra. Sorry, the OP is an algebra. And these are exactly the structure constants. So when you have an algebra, you remember that you have like the commutator of AI, AJ is equal to FIJK, AK. These are the analogous of the structure constants for the OPE algebra. And the crossing symmetry, in a very mathematical way, is associativity of this algebra. Any other?
Let's continue with David and Dan.